The Apostle Paul says in 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 2 that in the last days, perilous times shall come. And of course, history and time as we know it is going to come to a close. The Bible makes it very, very clear. But preceding these final days, these final days of planet Earth as it is, as we know it, Paul says perilous times will come. Now, when we look at perilous times, we look around us and we see the fact that we are capable of destroying ourselves through nuclear weaponry several times over today. We see all types of diseases rampant, difficulties coming, distresses touching nations, governments, the minds of people, institutions falling and collapsing, the underbelly of corruption, even in a free and what used to be moral society, now being exposed every day in the papers. God doing everything in His power to bring America to an awareness of her need. Not only America, but everywhere, every country, to their need of God. I pray that we have the ability to hear. Perilous times, if you really look it up in the Hebrew text, the word perilous doesn't mean what we necessarily think it means. The word perilous means of a situation which brings about a decrease in strength. Now, Paul is always speaking from the context of the Christian church. The world, I suppose, was part of his focus, but he's speaking to Christians. And he says there's a time coming when there is going to be an environment that if it's not understood, and if a Christian church does not choose to walk in separation from this environment, the environment itself, if it has any part in the lives of God's people, is going to bring about a decrease in spiritual strength. And we're living in a perilous time because many of God's people in His house are no longer separated, or their separation from the ways of the world is very minimal. And the ways of the world's thinking has gotten into the spirits and the minds of many, many, many of God's people. And many even assemblies today are led by what they believe is the Holy Spirit, but it isn't. It's an unholy corruption that's dominant in the lives of those who are intertwined with the ways of this world. See, a society one day embracing the concept of killing its children for the sake of convenience. But yet that's where much of the world is coming to today. We call murder now choice. And it's all for convenience. Society wants to sin, but wants no part of the responsibility as it is that comes with their actions. So we will simply take human life for convenience sake. You see, immoral spirits now donning religious robes and trying to redefine truth even in the house of God. He says in chapter 3, verse 8, there are men of corrupt minds, reprobate concerning the faith. I wonder, did Paul see, and I believe he did, see this one, godless men leading large gatherings of Christians into their own personal delusions, prophesying as they have always done in the Old Testament times out of the deception of their own hearts, and enhancing and promoting get-rich-quick-through-Christ schemes in the Church of Jesus Christ. Corrupt minds and reprobate concerning the faith of Jesus Christ. Now, the Bible doesn't present a glorious picture of the last days on earth. In spite of the fact that there are some out there are saying the church is going to be overcoming and victorious and conquer political kingdoms and present to Christ a glorious rehabilitated earth, if these folks just took time to read their Bibles, they would begin to understand that's not what the Scripture says. The Scripture conclusively proves that godlessness is going to invade much of the professing church. And in society, a rebellion against God and His Word is going to reach astounding proportions. And we're moving very quickly into it. If anyone here is conversant with the news, if you do read the newspaper, if you are aware of the social agendas and issues that are creeping into society, we are very, very quickly moving into an absolute rebellion against God and everything that God speaks in His Word. If I live long enough, I can foresee a day when preaching the gospel very well may be considered hate. Now, the principle is very simple. The world as we know it is about to perish. It is destined to perish. The moment that Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, this world as we know it was destined to die. 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 10, Peter says, "The day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat, The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burnt up. Peter says, suddenly, quickly, comes this Holocaust of some sort. And he hadn't the scientific knowledge to write down what he was writing. He said, it appears that even the heavens, the elements are going to be on fire. Can you imagine the doubters of Peter's day reading his words? Say, come on, Peter. You mean even the air itself is going to be on fire? I remember Oppenheimer, one of the scientists who developed the atomic bomb. There was a tremendous fear in these men the first time that they set off the first atomic device, not a nuclear device, but an atomic device, that they were going to actually set the atmosphere on fire in planet Earth. And they were not sure that the detonation of this device was not going to actually do this. But Peter said, I foresee in the spirit of day when the elements themselves are going to melt because of the fervency of the heat, and the earth and the works that are therein shall be burnt up. And secondly, everyone who draws their sense of purpose and life from this corrupted value system is going to perish with this world. It is conclusive. You leave the doors of this church, go out on Broadway, look at all the flashing lights, look at all of what society has to offer. If this is your source of value, if this is what you are pursuing, if the value system of this corrupted world is your value system, it is conclusive that you're going to perish with this world. Because the Bible says that whoever is in Christ, or whoever Christ is in, has a new value system. These old things begin to pass away, and all things begin to become new. Your affections turn from the things of this world to the things of God. You begin to be aware that you are seated now in heavenly places with God in Christ Jesus. Your perspective is eternal. The compassion that comes into your heart, the desire, is right in line with the desire of God to see this fallen world know that it is heading for a fire much worse than the one that Peter is describing, but an eternity without God in a place called hell, where the Bible says very clearly there is fire, there is weeping, there is gnashing of teeth, there is burning, there is everlasting destruction. This is the future of those who are without God. Make no mistake about it, folks. I know this type of preaching is not very popular today, but beloved, that is in the Bible. This is what the scripture says. Now, the call of Jesus Christ has always been to come out of its misguided direction. This world is misguided. And even much of its theology today is misguided. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 6 and verse 14, he said, be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. What fellowship has righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion has light with darkness? Now, we quite often associate this with perhaps business practice or our marriage. And these, of course, do have an application. But it's beyond that. Take it a step further. I believe that Paul is saying, don't walk with the ungodly. Don't think like the ungodly. Don't let their scorning get into your minds. Don't stand with sinners. Don't sit in the seat of the scornful. Let your fellowship be with those who know God. Let the mind of God be in you. Let your thoughts be set on things above and not on things of the earth. Because you are living and I are living in perilous times. And if we do not allow the Holy Ghost to bring us to a place where we make the break from these things, you and I will end up powerless. We'll have no voice in our generation. All we'll have is a mixture, and it will come out as a theological mixture. We are seeing prophets of delusion rise up now all over the nations, and they are speaking delusion, and it's because they have refused to be separated from the things of this world. They sit and allow their minds and eyes and hearts to be infused with thinking that comes from a perishing society, and then they try to incorporate this corrupted thinking into the Word of God. Paul says, don't be unequally yoked. That's why the cry, if you want to rebuild the temple, come out. If you want to be part of what God is doing, come out. It's a simple choice. And God says, I've made the way for you to do it. Turn it off. Get rid of it. Get away from it. Disassociate yourself from it. Don't go there anymore. Don't think this way. Don't do this. You don't realize how perilous this is. And what concord, verse 15, has Christ with Belial? Or what part has he that believes with an infidel? What agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, He says in verse 17, come out from among them and be separate, saith the Lord, and touch no unclean thing, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you, and you shall be my sons and my daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. Now Peter says in 2 Peter 3:11, he says, seeing all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness? Now think it through for just a moment. All things are going to be dissolved. This theater will be dissolved. Broadway will be dissolved. Wall Street will be dissolved. Everything we know is going to be dissolved. The Bible makes it conclusive and clear. In the last days, there's going to be a dissolving of these things. They're going to start with perhaps this gradual unraveling. I don't know, but it's going to end up absolutely dissolved. That's what the Scripture says, and I'm not going to argue with the Scriptures. Peter says, knowing these things, what kind of people should we be? That's a good question to ask ourselves today. Knowing these things, what kind of people, what kind of person should I be? What kind of person should you be? And it even begs a deeper question. What will your last days be like? What will they be like? Psalm 139, verse 16, David says, in thy book all my members were written. Let me read it to you from the New Living Testament. And actually, every other modern translation says it the same way. Here's what David is saying. Lord, you saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed. David said, God, you saw me, and every day of my life was recorded. So, in other words, the Lord knew the day I was born, and he knows the day I will die. When I breathed my first breath, and when you breathed yours, we were both given an allotted time to seek and find the God who created us, the God who longs to bring us home to an eternal place. We have an allotted time, beloved. It's not a long time. James calls it just a vapor, like a puff of breath on a cold winter day. We're here, then we're gone. Given an allotted time to seek God. I think of the foolishness of multitudes throughout time who have cast off an eternity with God for a few moments of foolishness, a few moments of being gripped with godlessness, of pursuing gratifications of their natural man, their corrupted flesh, giving into these things and trying to tack on to it a measure of godlessness, or godliness rather, just a measure, just come to the church enough to say, well, God, you know, I was there. But deep in the heart, there's no natural desire for God. Some today here, you have a measure of time left to you. You have a great, some have a fairly good measure. You might have 5, 10, 15, 20 years. And, I mean, realistically, if the Lord tarries in 50 years or less, we will all be dead. Think about that for a moment. You'll be dead. Your body will either be cremated or buried or whatever is going to happen to you. Others, your time is very short. Statistically speaking, I'm standing here today addressing a rather large audience. I have preached to many people in my lifetime that are now dead. They're gone on to eternity, either to heaven or hell. And some here today, your time is very, very short. You may not have much more than another year. You might not have much more than another 6 months. Some may not have much more than another month. Some of you may not have longer than a week. And there may be somebody here who's not going to make it through the day. You don't know this, but God does. One thing I do know is that you were given a chance to find Him. You were given an allotted time to seek God. And don't play with that time. You're a very foolish person if you play with that time. This could be your last day. It could be mine. I'm very well aware of that. It could be your last week. It could be your last 2 weeks, your last month. You don't know how much time you have, and neither do I. But I do know that everything around that is not like God is going to perish. But what will my last days be like? And how will I finish this race if I'm even in it? And you and I need to ask ourselves that question. Now, I know I'm in the race. But you need to ask yourself the question, am I even in the race? And if I am, how am I going to finish?